Present. Counselor Simonetto is absent. And President Melon.
Present.
Is present. Quorum is present.
At this time, ask everyone to please rise for a moment of silence, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you're looking at the agenda for tonight, it says the next item on the agenda is public hearing. We're going to move that down to after the presentation so that it is, so that you can ask questions after. We're going to have another presentation. It's going to be slightly different information or additional information that was given at the Redevelopment Commission. So we will skip that at this time and put it in later. And we would now like to ask for a grade separation update from Joe Norman.
Good evening, everyone. The railroad agreements, we have come to an agreement with the railroad. Everybody was on the same page. We sent it back to the railroad for them to pass it up their chain for the approvals. I've inquired as to how they're going to do that, an estimated schedule. I've not gotten back yet, but as far as we are concerned, the agreements have been completed and agreed to and are now back at the railroad. On the project basis, we did meet the other morning with VP. They have to discuss the closure they're going to do on East 45th Street. That'll come up sometime in March or in April. They will be coming to the council with what the schedule is for it, a two-week closure, what they're going to do. So we had Public Works there, we had everybody there, so we're all aware of it. And as soon as we get some plans, we will submit that through and run it to Public Works and run it to the council so everybody's aware of what's going on with that. We're trying to target a week of spring break in there, but I don't know if we'll be able to do that. That's something that we're looking to do. Another thing that came up was we are removing one of the light poles on Calumet, just south of the tracks on the east side. That has to do with the location of the NIPSCO pole line on the south side. They had to, NIPSCO had to coordinate with the hospital to do a cut-in, and they have to do that on Sundays. They're not doing it this Sunday, they're doing it the following Sunday, so they're gonna string those lines that following Sunday. We have to have that pole removed prior to that. Public Works is aware of it. We already talked to Midwestern Electric. They will be out early next week to remove that light pole so that that work can go ahead. So things are coming into place about all the utility stuff that we have. And that's really about it right now that we have. So, is there any questions at all? All right, thank you very much.
At this time, we will open to the public, and if you want to save your questions for anything regarding the lease mechanism, there will be another opportunity for that later in the meeting. But at this time, if you wish to address anything, open to the public is 2 minutes maximum per person or 5 minutes for a group spokesperson. Please keep your comments civil and constructive to public policy issues. The chair at its sole discretion may recognize individuals wishing to speak on different topics at any time and may end the open to the public session. All speakers will be timed by the clerk treasurer, and this portion of the meeting shall not exceed 20 minutes.
Something different this time.
Mike Kimmel, 1833 Tool Plain. Just a question. Last meeting, it was brought up about you putting out for bids for the solid waste, and the gentleman from Waste Management had said something about there was a year's extension, I guess, on the current contract. And I know you put it out for the bids. My question is, the rate that they were going to give for this extension, if it were better than what you were going to get for the bids you put out, what happens? Did that extension get taken off the table?
Mr. President, if I might.
Yes.
I think, Mike, tell me if I'm not clarifying that, tell me I'm wrong.
I think what Mike is saying is, let's assume the bids come in higher than any extension period we could grab with waste. Can we still grab that extension, or what happens? Are we beyond it? Assuming there's an extension period left.
I see where you're saying.
There was like two.
Let's say I can do this for you for another year for $3.
Right.
And we say now we're gonna bid it out, and it comes in at $4 from Allied and from waste.
Do you have a concrete answer, or are we gonna think this out?
I'm with you.
That was my question.
I have an answer. I don't know that as much. I mean, give you the answer. The answer is that you have the right to reject all bids when they come in, right? And then that puts you back to where you're at, which is either back to the decision point of go out to bid again, or if that extension is still being offered and you have the legal right to take that extension to begin with, then you can take that extension. Now, it may not be being offered at that point, so you don't know, but you have the legal right to reject all bids that come in. So if you get two bids and they're really high, you would reject those.
See if the offer is still there.
The
extension periods in the waste hauling agreement itself, the original one, have been exhausted. This was an offer saying we'll do it again for another year. So we don't have a writing to fall back on to say we'll take you up on it. Mike, I think this happens in, you know, a lot of the agreements we do. After a certain period of time, you have to say, let's see what's out there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was my understanding. We've been with waste for, is it five years? I think we had Allied for maybe longer prior to that. I would not be looking forward to, you know, going through the new garbage can thing again, which was moderately problematic.
Go from blue to green to blue again.
Do we just paint them?
Okay.
Anyone else?
Julie O'Connor. My address is 1104 Elliott Drive. Three questions. One is about the timing of redevelopment. Do you anticipate it's going to precede the town council meeting going forward, or was this just special for today? My second question is, what was the time and date that the agendas went onto the website? And my third question is, Mr. Schaefer, could I talk to you after the meeting?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Question one, the Redevelopment Commission will precede town council just this once, and that is because mechanically the Redevelopment Commission must approve the resolution before council ordains the kind of sister item that is on the agenda. Council could not ordain it and then the Redevelopment Commission retroactively approve it. It has to go A, then B. Your second question was, when were the agendas posted? The agendas were posted Friday afternoon, I believe around 4:30. The public notice for the public hearing at both the Redevelopment Commission at 6:30 and the Town Council public hearing were issued at least 10 days ago, but I think it was more like 11. So, and the third question was for Dave.
Right, Dave answered in the affirmative, if I recall.
Thank you, Ben. Anyone else?
Hey, it's Harrison Avenue, Munster, Indiana. The one thing I want to say is, are you guys looking at videotaping town council meetings, special meetings, or any meetings that have to do with the town? Have you guys gave that any thought? Is the first thing I'd like to say. And the second thing is, I think it would be nice if at possibly the next meeting or pretty soon, that you might consider giving a resolution to Tom Davis for videotaping these for a very long time now. So the whole town is aware. That doesn't make it here, but I know a lot of people look on his site and watch the videos, including Dustin. Thank you.
So the answer is yes. We're looking at a number of options. Tom and I did talk. I know that he is not long for taping these meetings. And his taping these meetings has been a great service to his fellow residents and to the town, for which it's very, very appreciated. I'll have to ask Tom personally if he would like a resolution, and we'll go from there. I don't know the answer to that question. But not to say more importantly, but to your specific question, yes, I agree and I believe that the town council, not to speak for them, would likely agree that the videotaping and the broadcasting of these meetings is a distinct public service, and we will figure out how we will move forward and continue that service for our residents.
Okay, anyone else wishing to speak in the open to the public session? Close the open to the public session and moving on to the consent agenda.
I move to accept the consent agenda as given. I'll second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. Mr. Schaefer, can you take the roll, please?
Yes, ma'am. Councilor Kulturitis.
Yes.
Votes yes. Councilor Nellens.
Yes.
Votes yes. Councilor Reed.
Yes.
Votes yes. Councilor Simonetto is still absent. And President Mellon.
Yes.
Votes yes. Votes 4-0.
Moving on to general orders. Ordinance number 1736, site plan committee second reading document. It's ordinance 1736.
So this is second reading of 1736. I think we had a pretty robust conversation last time and staff's direction for how we move forward with the plan commission and future amendments is unambiguous. There are no changes to the ordinance as it's presented to you versus the first read. There will be the feedback that we receive incorporated in the next item to be considered by Plan Commission, specifically the moving of the two Plan Commission members from the text of the ordinance into the list of members of the Site Plan Committee. So I think that's change that is easily made that we will absolutely incorporate in the future amendment. And what we're looking for is by a roll call vote, adoption of ordinance 1736.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Mr. Schaefer, will you please take the roll?
I'm sorry, was that Mr. Reed who
second.
Second. Thank you. Kilkey on 1736. I turn to Councilor Kulturitis.
Yes.
Votes yes. Councilor Nellens.
Yes.
Votes yes. Councilor Reed.
Yes.
Votes yes. President Mellon.
Yes.
Votes yes. 4-0.
All right, moving on to new business. We have agreement for online payments.
The town currently offers residents the ability to pay their water bill online with a credit card. The provider that we have for that, we've been having some problems with. It's a cumbersome process for the staff. It's cumbersome for the residents. We've found another provider that can offer same services and some additional services. One of the things that we hear often from residents is they want to be able to set up one time, have it charged to their credit card, and then they don't have to think about it anymore. The current provider does not support that. This new provider will. They are a partner with the software that we use for our utility billing, so there's integration there. There's no additional hardware needs for the town. All of the credit card information is stored on their servers. They are responsible for all of that. We don't have to worry about it, having that credit card information, those compliance issues. We would like to switch and use this other provider. The cost associated with it, we have three options. One is the town can pick up the cost completely for it, which would mean $2 per transaction if it's a credit card or a debit card, and then $1 if they do an e-check where it's pulled straight from their checking account. We're estimating that to be about $1,300 a month. Right now we pay about $940 a month for it. The other option is we can set it up as a user fee. So as an individual chooses to use it, they would pay $295 for the transaction, regardless of what the payment type is. And then the other option is we can do a hybrid of those two, where the town covers the cost completely, but we pass on some other fee to the user. It could be a nominal amount, something just to help defray those costs. So what we're looking for is authority to enter into this agreement and guidance on how you want the fees to be handled.
Madam President, if I might.
Yes.
And Trish, I just under the three options, the town, if we absorb the fees, it will pay $2 for a credit or debit card transaction and $1 for an e-check, okay? If we have the residents just pay flat out, whether it's an e-check or a debit card transaction, it's $2.95 per transaction, so it's more money for the residents. Under the hybrid option, what it sounds like is we would just say, okay, you're doing a credit, you're bringing a credit card into the office, and your bill is $100, or you know, you're doing this online. You want to swipe it, it's going to be a $2 fee. You want to do an e-check, it's going to be a $1 fee. We collect it and then we pay it over. Is that cheaper for the residents, or am I missing something?
It would be cheaper for the resident because the town is paying for it then.
Yeah.
The town is absorbing that cost and the resident isn't paying
it. But aren't we collecting it? Let's say your bill is 100 and we say, okay, pay 102.
That's what we're asking you how you want us to do that. Do you want us to pass that $2 fee along? Because what we could
do. It's cheaper than passing $2.95 along.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Well, if you're interested in paying with a credit card, whenever I pay my license plates, if I want to pay with my credit card or my rewards points, I pay the $2, whatever it is. So bottom line is we're going to lose money if we actually start absorbing those fees. So if a resident wants to do this and forget about it, I would say just push it right onto them. I don't feel the town should be losing any more money in regards to that. Because you're giving them a service, they just have to pay for that service.
But if we do the hybrid, the resident pays less. We collect that fee and pay it over? Is that what I'm trying to understand the hybrid option. It says the town would pay the fees under the absorbed option, and the user would pay a flat amount as determined by the town to defray the
cost. I don't know that we can say it's going to be the $2 and we pass on $2. I don't think that the vendor is going to let it be that. I think they're going to want it to be some lesser amount that where we are just helping to. We're just asking the resident to defray a portion of the cost, is what I think the expectation is there. I did not ask that question in that exact way when I was talking to the vendor.
I might ask the question, if we pass on a user's fee of $2.95, will that cover all the expenses?
Yes.
I guess from what I'm hearing, most folks like the convenience. While I'm not looking to charge a fee, I'm not looking for the town to absorb $1,300 a month on this action. And again, if someone wants to come into the window and pay or mail in a check,
there's no fee.
If they set up for automatic deduction.
If they do ACH, there's no cost.
There's no cost. So there's options for the residents to have no cost. I think to make it simple, if you just put the $2.95 on there, they choose to option it, that's fine. If they don't, there's other ways that there's no cost.
Believe me, I'm fine with either way. I just want to make it as cheap as possible. There's nothing wrong with bringing in checks and doing ACHs,
right.
But under the 21st century model, checks are dying. This is going to be a paperless program in our lifetimes.
Probably. That's the millennium.
Yeah. Well, they don't have checkbooks anymore. But
right.
I guess if I knew more about the hybrid option, I would be more comfortable with it. Not that the $2.95 is exorbitant, but I'm with you on what we want to do. I wish I knew more about the hybrid option, I guess, is all. I don't know. It sounds to me like that's an option where, okay, the town, basically what I'm reading it, the town would pay the fees as listed under the absorbed option, which is $2 for credit card and $1 for each check, both cheaper than $2.95, right? And the user would pay a flat amount as determined by the town to help defray the cost. So if our costs under the absorbed option are $2 and $1, don't we just charge the, like Trish said, I don't know if you got that specific with the company, Paymetheus here, I think is what it's called. But maybe that's worth asking. I know it's not, we're talking about 20-some thousand residents, I get it. It's a lot of money in the long run, but if we can get them a better deal, we probably ought to do it, even if it's $1 or $1.50 a transaction.
Or even if there's another company that does this trash. Are there other services?
There are. The problem that we have run into is one that works with our software, which is why we are presenting this one, because they have worked with our software, they're a partner with them for many years.
Maybe they can come back with a different.
How much of a headache would it be to just have it at the next meeting? I'm not an instructionist, you know what I mean?
That's fine.
One of the comments that, not to enter into the debate, but what we have heard at the counter is the comment that if someone who pays cash for their water bill, they say, well, why should my rate that I'm paying, if the town's going to absorb this additional fee, then the cash payer says, well, why am I subsidizing somebody who is paying by some other mechanism? So there is some validity to that. I don't know how much that weighs into your decision.
Right, and John, you're just saying that if we can have a lower fee for the residents by collecting it, not that the town would absorb anything. I mean, you're not interested in the town absorbing any cost, because I think we all agree that convenience is a service that we pay for in, I mean, when we withdraw money, when we do a lot of things, pay other bills. So, and to have, and to your point, Dave, to have other residents who do like to, that do still use checks or come in, to have them help offset other people's convenience fees does not seem right. But so we're just basically looking at this last hybrid issue as if we collect two, then we can have them pay. If we have them pay two, that's what we're gonna have to pay. Just as long as it's a wash, but maybe it can be a little bit lower. Mm-hmm. So is that the clarification everybody's looking for?
Just to see if it's available, if we can do something to balance that out.
Okay. Do we need to take any action as far as holding this till next month?
Sounds like you're going to move to table this matter until the meeting of February the 19th.
I make a motion to table this matter until February 19th, so we can do further research on the hybrid option.
I'll second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay, the ayes have it. Thank you, Tricia. Okay, moving on. Second, okay, so on to, pardon me, Mechanical Concepts Maintenance Agreement Renewal.
Mechanical Concepts is the firm that maintains our boiler here in town. Provides on-call services. He doesn't kick out the air conditioner, doesn't kick out things like that. Mm-hmm. We've been with them for a while. They would like to extend their prices at no increase for a year. They present a second option that is a three-year option that increases by 2% each year. I think consistent with what the council has looked for in other service contracts, you would probably want to go out to bid next year. I think a no-cost increase this year is a pretty good deal, and it would be my humble recommendation that you consider it, at least. But we have no problem going out to bid. The issue is that, you know, our system is a little unique in its complexity, and Mechanical Concepts does have the benefit of knowing it inside out. We basically have the same gentleman who comes and helps us out when we need it. He has a large amount of institutional knowledge, and to keep the price the same for another year, I think is, in this day and age, a pretty fair shake. So what we would look for is some direction from council.
Madam President, I need to be the question guy tonight. Dustin, I think you had said under option two, they want a 2% increase each year for three. So it looks like there's just a 2% increase from year one to year two, and that holds there.
Third year,
three.
Sure.
Is that right? Okay, so there's just, okay. I mean, it goes up $100 one year, and then it stays the same for the next year. So, I would make a motion to approve the contract with Mechanical Concepts for the maintenance agreement, option number two.
Option number two?
Yes.
Which is?
3-year period. The 1-2% increase in year two, and then hold steady again for year three.
I'll second that motion.
All, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. All right. Moving on to lease purchase of police and fire vehicles. Item C.
Okay, so at a previous meeting, I believe in November or December, you accepted the bids for the costs of the squads. In that intervening time, we have worked to identify all the costs associated with outfitting those squads. There's certain mounts and hardware, lights that may or may not be able to be reused. Once that paperwork was completed, that due diligence was done, that came back to our office, and here it is before you. So what you're being asked to approve is the now financing, the lease purchase financing of those vehicles, that you approved the bid on. And this is executed the same way we've done this for as long as I've been here, and I think, not to put either of the clerk treasurer staff on the spot, for many years preceding that.
Okay, counselors?
I move we approve the financing for the 7 police department and 2 fire department fully equipped emergency vehicles for the total cost of $368,751.
I'll second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. And the ayes have it. Moving on to item D. 1737 lease mechanism.
So this is the sister mechanism that council will ordain because the redevelopment commission can't ordain something they resolve. So this is the town council codifying the redevelopment commission's lease agreement with the redevelopment authority. That's the layperson's version. Brad?
Correct. Yes, under Indiana law, before a redevelopment commission can enter into a lease with an authority, the council has to approve that lease as well as the terms of any bonds that were going to be issued and secured by that lease. So this particular ordinance covers those matters. I think you should have a copy of that. Section 1 goes through the various maximum parameters, which would be lease term no greater than 20 years, same thing with the bond term. Maximum lease rental payment cannot exceed $450,000. That's what Matt spoke about at the redevelopment commission meeting as to how we got to that amount. It authorizes the maximum interest rate not to exceed 5%. Again, you won't know that until you actually would sell bonds. And the other important piece that this ordinance would do is to appropriate money that is received from the authority in exchange for selling the lease premises. Because you've not included that amount in your budget for the 2018 calendar year, you have to conduct the additional appropriation hearing on that amount that you'll then use to fund part of the grade separation project.
Okay. At this time, we will conduct a public hearing. So anyone in the public who wishes to speak regarding this lease mechanism, please feel free to come up now.
Julie O'Connor from 1104 Elliott. Could we just get a copy of that analysis that was not attached?
Yeah, it will be included on the grade separation project tab on the town website.
Great, thank you.
All right, anyone else wishing to speak at the public hearing? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Oops, I keep doing that, these glasses. All right. Counselors?
I would make a motion for a roll call vote to approve Redevelopment Commission Resolution 049.
Second.
Mr. Schaefer, can you take the roll, please?
Correct
The ordinance 1728, is that what you meant?
Well.
Well, we have in sections.
I'll tell you that the recommendation at tonight's meeting is by motion and roll call vote, approve redevelopment commission resolution 049, which we're ratifying the redevelopment commission's action.
It would.
No? Go ahead, David.
You need to approve ordinance 1737.
Does the town council doing anything with resolution 049?
By virtue of the fact that you would approve ordinance, and I see Brad.
They're not here in that order, and I know the order is important.
But by approving ordinance 1737, you are in fact ratifying the resolution of the redevelopment commission.
And I withdraw my motion and make a motion by voice vote to consider ordinance 1737 on first read and set second reading and adoption for the February 19th town council meeting.
Second.
Right, we have a motion and we have a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. All opposed? Hearing none, the motion carries.
Next one to ordinance 1728. I'd make a motion to approve ordinance, I'm sorry, to adopt ordinance 1728 on first reading and set a second reading and adoption for the next regular meeting on February 19th, 2018.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. All right, moving on to item E, it's ordinance number 1728 establishing, oh, we just did that, wait.
Do you want to go back again on our list of things to do?
Yeah, the resolution.
Okay.
No? Okay. Is it?
So 1728 is listed separately.
Did
under
it?
The, pardon me? And we did it.
Did
yeah.
It.
Yeah, so, okay. So, item F, SEH project proposal.
From time to time, we've seen individual pieces of project work come before you that would be conducted by a town engineer. It's easier to keep track of costs and control those costs. For example, what you have before you is the project where we're going to manage that community crossings grant application, right? So we get a money pot of money from the state, we get a pot of money here, we'll put it together, and we're gonna fix a bunch of roads, right? What we're going to do this year, traditionally, we bid out our street resurfacing based on quantity price, right? We've said, well, how much would it cost, you know, per linear foot for concrete? How much would it cost per linear foot for this kind of road resurface, right? And I think, you know, we've had a one particular contractor, I think their work is good, right? But the way we do that, I think, is not the most efficient way. And I think if we were to write more accurate bid specifications specifically that will match what our application at the Community Crossings grant application said, those quotes that we get from your two major street resurfacing, Reith Riley and Walsh Kelly, will be a little bit more accurate and will probably be a little less than what we've traditionally paid, right? So this will allow for the creation of those very detailed bid specifications, one. And two, there's a compliance aspect with running one of these NDOT projects where you have to have a large amount of transparency when things were paid out, what pay items were approved, what pay items were change orders, things like that. It's a person, right? It's a person in the field constantly checking the vendor's work. And they did that last year for the road resurfacing. Mm-hmm. They've done a very good job with our ADA work when we replaced all those curbs. And we would recommend that that be in here. But when you get things like that, you get people out in the field, there might be those change orders. What this does, it allows us to cap that price, right? For that project amount. Whereas if it was just hourly, you know, who knows, and whatever, right? But now there's an incentive to control those costs a little bit more proactively by that firm.
Right. Thank you. Counselors?
I'll make a motion that we approve the attached SEH proposal for the Community Crossing Grant Rehabilitation Project.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The motion carries. All right. Item G, a new business, interlocal agreement with LCRBDC.
This is a late request by the Little Calumet River Basin Development Commission. They would, for their own accounting and bookkeeping purposes, prefer to have this executed sooner rather than later. It was our intention to have everything, the bids for the SCADA system and everything, all together in one meeting, wrapped up with a bow on it, so you could consider it. But Little Cal is a great partner to the region and the municipalities in the region. And we are no exception. And if they, for their convenience, would like to have this executed now, I think it makes perfect sense to be a good neighbor and execute this interlocal agreement. Basically, what you're being asked to do is say it is okay that the Little Cal Commission let us use some of their money for the public's benefit, which is a good thing for the residents of Munster, and it's a good thing for the residents that live within the Little Calumet River Basin watershed. So,
and this is an outright contribution or grant. It's not a loan or anything
that's
else.
Correct.
Which I think, you know, it's a great step, and this is something closer to where I wanted to be as far as having monitors on all the generators so that we know what's going on.
And we will get to 100% on that goal. So you'll notice that this was adopted in December, and the person to execute this contract is the then council president, Mr. Simonetto. I asked the attorney for the Little Cal if it would be okay to just scratch that name out and you to sign it. Yeah, that's fine, but just for the benefit of anybody who might read this document in the future online or anything like that, that's not an issue.
I'll make a motion that we approve the interlocal agreement between the Little Calumet River Basin Development Commission and the Town of Munster.
Second. Is that a roll?
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
For the record, I abstain.
Okay. All opposed? Seeing none?
Who was the second?
No, John.
I didn't do anything.
I thought you said who is abstain. Okay.
I can't very well second and then abstain.
They're always abstain.
All right, the motion carries.
Thank you.
Great.
All right. Reports, we have none. Announcements. First, we put out the announcement that we will be, the clerk treasurer will be accepting applications for the redevelopment authority. There will be, correct me if I'm wrong, there will be three on the redevelopment authority. So if you're interested, anybody in the public, any citizens, residents of Munster may apply for that through the clerk treasurer's office. And do we have not set a time on that. Do you have any suggestions as far as time?
Well, I would say that, you know, give people a chance to grab an application online.
Right.
Fill it out and submit it to the clerk treasurer and allow that nominating committee to do its work.
Right. So,
perhaps at the second meeting in March, we would appoint.
Appoint in the second meeting March. So therefore, I would say the second meeting in March is the 19th. So if we could have March, all applications by March 1?
I think that's more than reasonable.
Yeah. With it being it's only the 5th today, so yes. Okay, so there's that, and then all town council meetings will begin at 7 o'clock p.m. Unless otherwise noted, there is no meeting on February 12th. There'll be a regular town council Amarillo, followed by redevelopment commission meeting on February 19th. No meeting on February 26th. On March 5th, there'll be a regular town council, followed by redevelopment commission meeting. March 12th, no meeting, and March 19th, regular town council, followed by redevelopment commission meeting.
I'll move for adjournment.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?